you doing, Nate?
Hey, Dad.
Ready for my first show?
Yeah.
All right, here we go. Baby boy.
Prophecy foretold of a great band of warriors that would come forth unto Donington and would slay all before them. The band was Jonathan Davis and the SFA.
Oh no.
This whole idea came about when I did the first solo tour with my band JDSFA. I always wanted to go out on tour and do the Queen of the Damned songs. And it always bugged me, I never did it. So I finally got, we had a little bit of time off, so I got a group of musicians together and we went out and did those.
But I want to dedicate this song to all the fucking incredible Korn fans in the crowd tonight. It's because of you, I have everything in my life. Thank you guys very fucking much. Thank you for supporting me on this. And make a big round of applause for my band, the SFA.
And I didn't have enough material to do a show, so I had to do some Korn songs too. We did our take on him. We had an amazing band. Joe Come on drums, who was, I think he was the pig back in the backing band. He did the percussion when Korn did the backing band thing back on See on the Other Side. So I had Joe Come on drums. I had Miles Mosley on stand-up bass, Shankar on violin, Zach on keyboards, and Shane Gibson on guitar. Shane is not with us anymore, and he was an amazing guitar player. We all went on tour, didn't know what we were gonna do, and then we got the band together, and we just went on the road and just winged it. We did a couple rehearsals, we knew the songs, but we didn't know what we were gonna do, so it kind of took on its own thing.
You guys do not know how fucking scared I was coming up here at the start of this fucking show. You guys made me feel a hell of a lot better.
And I had this throne that was been in the storage. It just kind of happened that I wanted to take it out, I was gonna sit on it, I ended up doing the whole show sitting down. The whole show, I sat until the very last song. Download, when I played the little tent, it was crazy because it's a smaller tent, but I think the whole festival showed up. I love that show. It was amazing. Everyone was just tripping out. They didn't know what to think. And by the end of it, when I stood up, it went crazy. Felt good to get some love from the fans because it wasn't a heavy show. Nothing about it is heavy. It was more acoustic and a different vibe, but that's what I wanted to do. That show was amazing.
You couldn't.
That was one of those shows, man.
The prophecy came true. With weapons that looked like instruments, they slayed Donington.
Jadis VA became nicknamed by my old my old friend Loke, the Simply Fucking Amazing, because the level of musicianship, all these guys were no joke. They came in right away. I mean, the first day of rehearsal, we had sheet music, which we had sheet music printed out, and they just read it. And I knew from there, and I was like, oh, I got some badass musicians. Just jam and see what happens. So the show evolved over the year, and it got into this crazy musician. You know, the musicianship was out of this world. I had Miles battling Shane on solos. Shane was a just amazing guitar player, but Miles could keep up with him on a stand-up bass. And those two would go back and forth.
Everybody give it up to Miles and Shane. And Zach, Joker, and Shankar.
Shankar doing his thing. We'd do these vibe, we'd do these vocal percussion, these things that he taught me. Got into Indian music from him. He taught me violin. Me and him would go back and forth. There was a lot of just free. It wasn't scripted. It was just all jamming. It was something special.
Simply fucking amazing, y'all. That's all I got to say tonight. Let's go kill him. Kill him on three. One, two, three. Kill him!
Two, three. Kill
him! I just felt the need to write a solo record after I did the JDSFA tour because I felt like I just had so much fun with that band. I played the Queen of the Damned songs and I played some Korn songs, but I wanted to do some original songs that I wanted to start writing just for me and see what happens. So right after that tour, I jumped on the Korn tour and I brought out a studio with me and I just started writing songs. I didn't have to prove anything to myself. I just felt like I needed to do this because I did the songs for the Queen of the Damned and everybody loved them so much. I felt I'd be robbing them and myself if I didn't go explore that avenue, really. I mean, I got everything I need with Korn. This is more about me exploring something different as an artist. And I'm glad that I did, because it came out amazing, in my opinion. Choking on air, something's making me breathe. I think underneath my skin was just, I love the song. Lyrically, it's about not giving in, but it's about me dealing with depression and dealing with, you know, when I got sober and all kinds of stuff. It's what you feel like when you're going through that stuff and you're feeling like you're going batshit crazy. You feel like your skin crawling, like there's something actually underneath there. And it goes back to the other thing of doing like the Gansfeld experiment when you have those visions and stuff. I wanted to kind of give that vibe of you're tripping out. I like the song and that's what I just thought it would be the best one to open up with. I got sober in 98. Crazy. I mean, it's not even an issue anymore. I don't even think of it as like, oh, you're so sober. I'm past that. It's not even an issue. Some people work programs and it's their whole life to stay clean, and I get that. I understand. For me, it's the last thing I want to fucking think about. It's always the last second. Everyone's asking for a title, and they're like, I'm like, it'll come to me when it comes. Just let me do my thing, and then boom, when that was badass, I'm like, that's... I was like, Black Labyrinth, that's pretty fucking dope. I woke up. I think I dreamed it. Something made those words pop in my head. I thought it was fitting. It represents my brain. A never-ending labyrinth where I turn and I hit obstacles and I got to go around and try and find my way through. everything. I think it just encompasses my life, basically. My life has been a giant black labyrinth. It felt like that was just the fitting title. It just worked with everything that was going on. And that's just how these things work out, man. I'm not gonna question it, how things pop in my brain. They say being inspired means, in Latin, with spirit, means that it's coming from a different place, and I'm never gonna question that. The music takes you on a journey. That journey is through the Black Labyrinth, which is my brain.
It's coming for me as I watch them march down this false line. I'm grabbing all the anger I can find. Alarming in this present face, destroying all these places in my mind. We're living in a
I wrote a couple songs. I think Final Days was one of them. Wrote a couple by myself, and then I ended up having Miles come out with me. I called him up and said, hey, I know I was touring Europe at the time. Oh, you want to come out with me and write some songs for my record? So, hell yeah, let's do it. So Miles came out. He brought a little electric stand-up bass, and we sat in those double-decker buses in Europe, and we wrote a couple songs together, and I wrote a lot of it in Europe. All the songs, working titles, where I was at. I have a song called Manchester, I have a song called Russia, Antwerp. It just depended where I was at, is where I wrote the songs. So I say 80% of the record was written in Europe.
Each city had its own kind of vibe to it. So it was a matter of, you know, opening up the window and looking outside, and whatever was out there, you could kind of get the feel for it. The way he puts it together is he's fast and he knows what he likes, and it's killing right off the bat with like no effort.
I had such a blast riding with Miles. We were doing stuff together, and then once we were done, he loved going out and going to jazz clubs. That's what he does, all right? So he'd go out in jazz clubs, and he'd do this thing called sitting in. You know, just go and watch the bands, and then he'd go, hey, can I sit in? I guess that's a thing you can do with jazz bands. He'd go up, and then he'd sit in, and he would spank the bass player so hard. He was so badass that the bass players would sometimes just leave or they'd just be like blown away and want him to play the rest of the set. I admire that in people that take their craft so seriously, do stuff like they've gotten so good. It was inspiring for me. I started writing. Once I had those songs done, I came back to my house in Malibu and started writing in my little guest house. And I started just working, and I set up these cameras in my house, and I had them going 24 hours a day on, was it Ustream? What was the thing called? Something like that back in the early, it was like 2007 or something. And I just streamed the whole writing process. I turned the audio off so you couldn't hear anything. People could watch me working and doing all this stuff. And then at night, I would turn on these traditional Japanese biwa music. It's this way they recite their poetry to this Japanese lute instrument.
That was fun. When nobody's sleeping on the bus.
Couldn't go to sleep.
Not on that bus. That shit was...
I was always talking.
Show, right to...
Writing.
Genelecs bumping through the ceiling. And the whole, like, everybody else's bus was all comfy and...
I got shit everywhere.
There was three studios being run all at the same time. What that is. I think that was me trying to figure out how to use the goddamn thing.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure that is it. It's cool.
Yeah, that's why it sounds whack. Because you were learning.
That's
not learning. Let's go with that.
Hey, you gotta have the shitty fucking...
Gotta have the ducks to have the swans, Mudry.
It was just, the whole process was fun. People would just sit there and chat with me while I was making the record in Malibu. And then I'd go from there once that was written. Then I would take it to our studio, which was a music grinder in Hollywood. Final Days, I wrote that about, it was during the war in Iraq was going on. And one of the lyrics is, they're bombing all the places left to hide. Seems like that place is, there's lots, it just, that's where humanity was created. Mesopotamia, wrote this song about that. I wanted that Middle Eastern vibe from, that's where I think that the world that we all came from. Schenker did an amazing job with his violin on parts, and he used his voice. He's got a humongous range. He's a legend. He had a band called Shock. He was with Frank Zappa, he was with Peter Gabriel. He has an amazing range on his voice, and his violin playing is out of this world. Schenker invented the double violin. He done amazing things with his violin. The whole thing is from a contrabass all the way up to a violin. It goes all the ranges. And he's just a very gifted individual, and he's done tons and produced tons of like 80s classic hits, and he's been involved with a lot of great people.
Shankar is fucking like, yo, I'm sick of being genius while y'all stumbling on your fucking parts.
You got that,
loop it,
because it was perfect pitch.
I'm gonna go through this other gig real quick.
I'll be back in an hour. You guys ready for the second song?
So to be able to take lessons from him was amazing, and I pick up, you know, instruments pretty quickly. I started the tour, first couple shows, and he gave me some lessons. And by like the fifth or sixth show, I was playing with him, and we got to do these jams. And I mean, I don't know what I'm doing. I just play by ear. But some of my favorites were me and him going back and forth playing, and him doing his thing, and we'd just do these long 10-minute jams on stage, and people seemed not to get bored. They just ate it up. Fondest memories on that tour is doing that. It'd be me, him, and Miles going at it, or me and him and Zach. It just depends on the night. Vocal stylings. We call them boom chocks from the Freak Unleashed stuff, but his stuff was like all these dooms. He was like doing doom, mataka taka doom. It's just these different voicings that. It's like percussive, and so he'd be like going doom, ataka taka doom, ataka taka doom. So he'd tell me to do that, and then he would do these other ones over the top, just doing this vocal percussion. And you can go on YouTube and see people doing these crazy vocal percussive things that they do in India. And he just hit me to that, and so we'd start doing it on stage. I'm like, let's just do it. I became where I didn't care. I wanted to experiment. I loved the rush of not knowing what we were going to do or how it would turn out. I became kind of addicted to that, not knowing in front of an audience. It's just throwing it all out there and not giving a fuck. Hey, we could train wreck, or it could be really cool, and it ended up being really cool. We'll be right back. tabla player, Mike Dillon. Zach hooked me up with him, and the original, when I wrote it, it had just loops, but I really wanted it to be real. Everything on this, I wanted this to be real, and when you hear it recorded and hear it on there, you know someone's playing them. It's not something programmed. It's not a machine. I really wanted to get that across and have a real guy play, and Mike did a great job. The whole thing, it takes you somewhere, and that's what I was going for. It's just that cool vibe makes you relax and lose yourself.
Alarming in its present face.
What is my religion? I believe in a higher power, obviously. I believe sometimes that this world that we believe in, or this universe, might be a simulation of some kind, and that it was designed by someone intelligent. But we'll never know until we die, really, will we? And it's just, this is my journey trying to figure that all out. Everyone's about Christian assimilation tactics. Like in the verse I'm talking about, I walk into this place because I need help, but I look different, so they just shun me. Like, who are you? And you have to change your ways if you want to be in God's house and all this stuff. So, I mean, I think a lot of people do that, and it just pisses me off to no end that in Christian churches, gays are persecuted and people are different persecuted. You know, in the whole scheme of things, if you're just trying to put a group of people together that care about each other, don't single out a person because they're gay, that they're going to bad. The only reason in the Bible it says gays are going to go to hell, and don't do it, because if two gay men get together, they can't have children. And if you can't have children, you can't pass that on, assimilate them into Christianity. That's the only reason they don't like gay people, man. Just come on, it's fucking apparent. If it's a religious thing about love, then you should love everybody. Y'all are full of shit. That's the vibe I was going for the song. And the rapid delivery of the lyrics and the chorus and all that is just, it's intense. It's just, I want to pound it over your head. So it's like me being a preacher. I'm pounding it over your head, preaching right to you just like they do. That's the vibe. You saw the What It Is video, so it's going backwards. So this is the next chapter backwards. So it's basically, you show up at this camp, encampment, this like Scientologist kind of like vibe, but we're going to say it that, but it's a Christian camp. It's like where they send people to be programmed. They sit down at a table, they drink this shit called blue milk, and you're chosen by the blue milk. If you're like not worthy, you start bleeding and puking profusely blood and you die. And the ones who are chosen open up a box and they have a gun in it. They put the gun on and they put the helmet on. They become those people that were beating my ass in the previous video. So it's how those guys are made. It shows how those dudes are made in this church, as the ongoing story of my journey of trying to figure out where I come from. As the video goes on, you'll see them being programmed. Now they're the Centurion guard fucks, and I come up as like public enemy number one because I'm outing what's going on. So that's kind of the gist of the video. I mean, the big thing about me doing the solo thing, I wanted to do something that was definitely way different than Korn. I'm not trying to do, I always play the joke that I'm not Steve Perry. It's not going to be Korn. If you're expecting some Korn type stuff, then it's not for you. It definitely needed to be something different. It's for me to exercise and do things different and learn. That's all I want to do, express myself in a different way. I think being the singer, the writer, the producer, everything for this record was cool. I mean, I didn't put no pressure on myself. I just wrote and did what I did. I always waited for a producer to come in and want to do work with me, but it never happened. But I love producing. So me and my engineer, Bud, who's been with me forever, wanted to make it sound the best we possibly could. But I produced it with Bud. He engineered, he came with the tones, but I knew what I wanted to hear and what I liked. And me and the engineer, Bud, Jim Bud Monty, have been friends forever. We worked on Untouchables together. He was this second engineer when I came in there to do vocals. After I got done doing that record, I asked him to be my assistant if he wanted to come on the road and see the world with me. And Bud went around the world with me, I don't know, 6-7 times. He recorded me while I was in my bus when I had all my equipment, and we did a lot of fun stuff together, and that started our relationship. He was mentored by Frank Filippetti, who did Untouchables, and Frank Filippetti is one of the best engineers in the business. I've watched Bud grow over the years and become an amazing engineer, and we did this project together, and he's always going to be, that's like my right-hand guy, that's going to always be my engineer. Every producer has an engineer, and he's their guy, and Bud's my guy. We did in the studio, and we did him just the same way we did back 10 years ago. Nothing changed. And sonically, he killed it, and he brought my vision. He brought out what I heard in my head. He made it happen. So he's a must for me. I can't think about working with anybody else. I love my Budry. Happiness. Musically, it was more of a rock song. I really wanted to experiment using different tones. I didn't want to do the corn guitar tone. I'm tuned in a different tuning and more single string playing and on smaller cabinets, and just me and Bud really experimented honing this tone that would be different from anything else. And when you listen to it, you can tell it's different. Yeah, I was doing those grindcore screams. This seemed like the song called for it. I can't take myself out of myself, of course. The only thing that Condit is has to do with corn is my singing style. When the song calls for it, it calls for it, and I just did what I felt, and that's how it came out. Yeah, I mean, Ray's an amazing, he's done a gajillion records, amazing session drummer. He can play anything and do different feels, everything. It's just, you gotta coach him along. I try to get his feel and get more swing and groove. Sometimes he'll lock more into straight time, just pounding, like that's his strong point, but he can groove too. It's getting him that spot. And then when you don't need that, if it's more percussion stuff, he just all around amazing percussionist and drummer.
That off the pedal technique. Even softer. This is a rare occasion right here. Me putting my heads on. Not that I'm too good to put my heads on. Not at all. It's not that. I'm just not what you call one of those great tuner tech guys. I like to hit things. I can hit things a lot better than I can put them on. Musicianship of this band is pretty insane. Really looking forward to playing with these fine musicians, Mr. Mal, Shane, Zach, and Shankar. I'm big fans of all those guys, so I think the lineup is quite fascinating, you know what I'm saying?
Every time I find happiness, there's disappointment right around the corner, and it's again about balance. But I want so badly one day just to do that. I think as humans, we never really, we can say we're happy, we're gonna have a lot of happy times, we'll have a lot of sad times. We don't truly find happiness, and what I gauge happiness is if I can go to sleep at night, just put my head on the pillow and go to sleep. I don't know anybody can do that. It's at least you think about some fucked up shit before you go to bed. So it's my search, it's my quest to find that true happiness, and one day hopefully I'll find it. There's all these interesting things that you can go and make a decision for yourself. It's not me to make that decision for you, but it just opens that little area of my mind to go, well, what if that's true? Or You know, I'm not gonna put myself in a box.
Come God, Creator, be our shield. Killer acoustics in this place.
Jesus was the first rock star, bro. I love the story of Jesus. He was persecuted because he became more popular than the Romans. That's basically what came down. He had a following. He had an entourage of 12 dudes. He went around preaching, which were rock shows. He did the same exact shit. And he was just preaching something that was to make people feel better. Same thing a lot of rock people do. I do it. I'm not saying Jesus, don't get that wrong, but it's what we do. So, of course, I like that. Oh, that's a good one. I even know the words. What a friends we have in Jesus. I know that one. Oh. Ah, this is my childhood. And we did the photo shoot of a beautiful church in downtown Los Angeles, Presbyterian Church. I've always loved religious art. It draws me in. I love those places, and I think it was just fitting with what's going on in the record of me in this journey. It's not by any means a religious record. And then when I saw the pictures and I looked at it trying to do it as an album cover, it looked like a Christian record. I was like, no. But I love just the gothic vibe of it. Most gothic stuff is church. So I love the architecture, I love the stained glass. I have a real problem with religion. I've had tons of people I love stole from me because of religion. I don't knock it. I respect people's beliefs. But as religion and as a whole, I can't stand it. It's responsible for every bad thing on this planet that's happened pretty much. I don't like the fact that a little island in another country went all over the world and destroyed every indigenous population on this planet. That was a lot of their religions and stuff was to keep this planet healthy, to keep it happy and in harmony. All these religions have destroyed that. I really hate the Christian assimilation tactics, which I talk about. It seems like they think they can get into heaven quicker by how many souls they save. People don't want to deal with that. So I think I came to grips lyrically on this was me going through in my head trying to figure out where to put my disdain for that. Now that I'm older and it's 10 years later, I realize that, you know, everyone's entitled to believe what they believe in, but I can say that I don't like it and it's fine. It's my opinion. But I wanted to keep the pictures in there, and I got my old friend David Stupakis to paint the album cover. He did the See on the Other Side cover for Korn. And if anyone got what I was going for, he did. And so he did this, and he incorporated the stained glass and the kind of weird church vibe. This package just came together like it should be. It shouldn't be hard. You shouldn't have to work at it. It should all fall in place.
You make me feel like I'm alive again. You make me feel like I can give in. I have nothing left to defend, which leaves the question, what should I do? What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? You make me feel like I'm alive again. You make me feel like I can give in. I have nothing left to defend. What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? What should I do?
I went to church young, right? Going through this, but then when I came to the realization that it was all bullshit, that this is man-made, not that Jesus and God is man-made story that it the church is, and their politics, and you know, if you come with them with a problem, and if it's not within their thing, they can't help it, then you're shunned, and that's something that always stuck in my head that's just so fucked up. Why would you do? You want to help people, you don't, well, you can't be here because you did this or that, be it if they're mentally ill or if they're gay or whatever the case may be. If you don't fit into the perfect mold in their church, they don't want you there. At the young age when I'm starting to figure this out, I felt like God had abandoned me.
Hey,
And I gotta say, the whole thing about this religious stuff that goes through the themes of me trying to figure it out, a lot of it was brought up because at the time I wrote this is when Head left the band, and I lost him because he became a fucking nut job Christian. Not that it was his honeymoon. He was over the fucking top nut job, coming off meth. I get it. We all go through it. And then a lot of Christians are born again. They have their honeymoon phase. And it just sparked that fire inside of me, just burning. And I had this in my... I had suppressed this a long time, my hatred for the stuff. But when he left, it just ignited that fire. And I just had to get all this out. And for a second, when he was working with me, Wes almost came and started to join Korn. And we were talking about it. And he came out and hung out with me and Reggie's place. And everything went down. But then I think Fred called him and they wanted to do some stuff, and he had his responsibility to, that was his band, and he had to go do that. So pretty crazy. It's how the universe works. I have a lot in the pipeline, but I wanted to do what I started and finish what I started. And this is that. And maybe the next one coming out, after we do the next one, it'll be completely different, and I'll be on a different trip, and I've done all kinds of different styles, but I needed to finish this. Walk on By is talking about me flirting with the all the dark things in my life have come around. I tell myself to just not engage anymore. It's more a newer thing. Just walk on by. Just keep going, John. I'm walking on the dark side. I can't get away. Feelings of loneliness engulf me every day. Yet I walk on by. I walk on by. I just got to stay on my path. It's more of a song of how to get through it. Don't get baited into that shit. I'm learning as I go that you can get baited into some dark side, baited into some drama in your life. Because it's a familiar place, but I'm trying to just go. It can be, and that can be with anything in life. If you're fucking alcoholic and you see a drink, keep walking, don't grab it. That it's just that kind of vibe of the song. I wrote that in 2010 on the Mayhem tour. So I found that they were on my Mikos, they're on the side there, and I'm like, oh, I forgot about all these songs. And Walk On By was one of them. Because I've had these songs for 10 years. I'm walking on the dark. When I was like, I meet with producers and stuff, they're like, what are you into? And I'm like, well, I've been working on this record and I play some songs, check these songs out. Just, you know, we were playing music and listening to music. And then I remember playing stuff. Don Gamera, like Spike In My Veins, Nick Rascuilla, just like Take Me. And I asked guys who want to do it, and they just took it and made the music different, but it was basically the same song. And they became Korn's songs. We don't care in Korn, it's no egos, no nothing. If it's a good song, I remember Love and Meth was a Love and Death song, so we nicknamed it Love and Meth. I had this stuffed squirrel, and I nicknamed them Biff. I named one of the songs Biff, and it ended up becoming Take Me, which, before my record came out, one of the producers, Nick Raskin, who liked it so much, ended up becoming a Korn song, Take Me. Very beginning, I just was just writing from my heart. I knew it was going something totally opposite. It was more of a vibe. It wasn't about being heavy. It was just about stuff that took me places. I've been saying that in the press. I want to take you somewhere. I just write from the heart, and whatever happens, happens. I wrote 20, almost 30 songs for this record, and 15 made it. I think there's like 12 or 13 on the record, but there's like extra tracks or whatever. There's still a lot of songs that I did. After I tracked the record, I had a label, obviously. The president of the label left. The person he wanted to produce it became the president of the label. He had no time to produce it, so I was just getting the runaround, basically. And I just asked them, hey, can I have my record back? And they gave me my record. And then it just sat in a computer for 10 years. I worked on some songs while I was writing more and more songs, but they just sat there. And I tried with the management we got next, and nothing happened. And finally now, the corn took a break, and then I got new managers. I have the chance to put it out now. Oh, The Secret was written by me, and I co-wrote it with Lauren Christie, who was in The Matrix, where we did those albums back then. It's about the end of a relationship. She was going through a rough time, I was going through a rough time with stuff, and we just put those feelings out on paper. It's fun to collaborate with people sometimes. I've been doing this so long, just to do something different. I've always written my own lyrics, but to co-write lyrics with people. Some people are like, oh, you're selling them. It's not for me, it's just I'm learning. And I enjoyed it, so fuck you. I mean, Zach brought a lot to the picture. He laid some amazing keyboard parts down. When he came in, I had most basic tracks done, and I really wanted him to do his thing on them, and I just let him, I go, well, do what you do, dude.
No.
What's up, pirate? I'll see you. Wanna put it on?
No.
Okay.
Plug and stuff like that. It was mostly all acoustic instruments. It was all acoustic. And this one I wanted to do a hybrid of stuff, so he's playing all kinds of keyboards, bellotrons, ambient, crazy noises, marching bells, and all kinds of stuff. So it's really nice to have him aboard because he's really a great musician and he can pull it off and it adds something that much more to the group. All the tricks that he uses. He's in different kinds of keys, different kinds of sound design. He uses his French Connection on stuff, and it's a keyword that you can use a ring, and it just glides.
Yep. Okay. Let's do this.
Hey! Hey!
Okay,
bud.
Yeah.
Hit it!
Alright, come on.
He's just an amazing pianist and keyboard player. He did. He really came through for me. Yeah, Ray likes to do those marching things when he feels the vibe. It was kind of that, the vibe, because Miles is doing this crazy cool thing with his bass. It's all these strings we're doing through that. It was just pretty epic. Just, it felt emotional. The music part, when I was going through living in the shadow shade for so long, it just lent itself to be that, you know, that it came up to be that amazing part. Lyrically, it's about all the things that I need just basically to survive. Just having that hope of having someone there to love me, or whatever it may be, that thing. It could be love, it could be family, whatever it is. Those are my basic needs that I need in my heart to really just survive. And I guess it's a kind of a love song of sorts, if I was to write one. I don't feel hunger. This record is something that I needed to finish what I started. I knew someday it would see its light, and finally that time's come. Queen of the Damned was the very first time I really did do anything solo. Once those were done, that just lit a fire in my ass. I had to write those songs on the road, so that started me down the road of just, you know, I had to keep writing. Once the movie was over, I didn't stop. I just kept writing songs and writing songs every night after Korn shows. I'd go on the bus and start writing stuff, so that's when I started. We always would document everything back then. I wanted people to be able to see it. I didn't know what it was going to be used for, but we did it. I mean, everyone loves that song. I don't get it, but it's a very epic song. I wanted to mix different styles of music together when I was doing that. We'll just talk about, like, in the middle part. A lute is going through there, Japanese, mixed with tablas and Indian. Just different styles of music all meshed together, like when you're mixing and DJing. I wanted to mix the two. Gave Shankar a chance to go off and write and do all kinds of crazy stuff violin-wise. And then it bounces back to Ray to be able to do kind of a drum solo thing. I was not mentally thinking, trying to go, oh, this is gonna be a single, so this song's like 5 or 6 minutes long, it's epic. I love the world music vibe. I mean, I love all the instruments. I love Indian music, because it's some alien shit, man.
It's a call to the aliens. It's an alien disc. You hear them? What? Check it out.
There's a whole step, and in between each half step, which is a half step down in our music, there's a semitone in between in Indian music. So there's like way more notes. They bend stuff and it's more minor. I've always was into that. And just like people, they dedicate their lives to playing tablas. They play these ragas. They're like 10 minutes long. How they view music and how it's played, the way they put notes together and bend notes. I just am into that. I don't even remember writing it. It was so long ago. It just kind of came about. Definitely got that dark world music gothic vibe, but that's just from me, what I was inspired by. I loved bands like Bauhaus, I love Peter Murphy, I love Dead Can Dance, I love all these different kinds of bands. When I was growing up, that's what comes out of me. And I have wrote happy pop tunes. It can do it, but this is what the vibe I was going for, and this is what came out. And I'm not going to argue with my subconscious. Obviously, is what's writing it. So this is how it is. I love the vibe of it. I don't feel hunger. I don't need air. There's blood in my veins, 'cause I know you are there. Worked really hard on it. Had to wait a long time and be patient. It's something very near and dear to my heart. I'm very happy how it came out. I just sit there and smile. I love it. I'm very proud of it. Medicate's about addiction, obviously. At the time, I was taking lots of Xanax for my anxiety. Who knows, I've had anxiety problems for years. So that's what inspired me. Medicate started out, Zach sent me the synth part. It was just that beat and the synth. And me and Bud put together all the crazy guitars and all that, you know, with the clean guitars and just build it into a different kind of vibe. And then I remember that day I took my brother, Marky, and put him in a rehab. It was a sober living house kind of rehab. And I just kind of came back and was reflecting on, dude, I'm addicted to these pills too. And not soon after that, I started kicking those pills for the first time, but I just wanted to get that out. And so I wrote Medicate, and the lyrics about that, about the things I deal with and how I had to take a pill to help me cope with those. And that's pretty much it.
Pattern, that floor tom thing's badass.
That floor tone thing's badass.
It was very just beautiful how it came, and I love, it's one of my favorite songs. It's just a drum beat, it's a drum loop, a synth, and clean guitars. That's it. So most of the album's very organic with real instruments from all over the world, different kinds of world instrumentation. This one is very digital, but it captured the same kind of vibe I was going for on the other songs. It's very minimal, it's a drum loop, some keyboards, and clean guitar, and my voice, and that's it. Lies come to pass, bells of black surround me, nothing ever lasts. I'm medicating every day to make it go. Look, is going on. This shit keeps dragging on. That one was inspired by watching one of my friends on tour deal with going back and forth with someone that he cared about very much and was being led on. And I couldn't watch him go every night. He would be so upset. And I just was writing that song. I wrote it in Russia. And I usually don't ever write lyrics on the road. I just wait until it's done and I come home and write them. But I was watching him go through hell and I just felt like I needed to write that to get it out, what I was going through. And let him listen, and maybe it helped him, and I think it did.
Hold on, and I fight it always.
Musically, that's all keys. And then at the very end, the last 20 seconds, the band kicks in, and that's Ray, Miles, Wes, and me on guitar.
It's weird. Oh wait, go right to where I did the...
Hey, he's hitting it with the...
Oh, wow!
Turn me up just a little bit more, bud.
The guest house in Malibu was very, very teeny. It was a garage, and it was just this little teeny little just like area up top. It was ridiculously small. We all had to cram in there, and my vocal booth was the closet. And me and Sebastian, he had to squeeze in there with the camera, and I had to squeeze in there and sing the vocals.
I just wanna be where I belong.
I used to laugh just thinking about this stuff we used to deal with up there, but I mean, it was just this really cool little space, and it inspired me there. I don't know. I just was really, Korn was on break and I really wanted to get this going, and that was the only space I had. It was like trying to go to the big studio in LA in Hollywood on the Music Grinder. It'd take me an hour and a half with traffic to get there, so I'd rather just sit in the room and do my thing. So please tell.
song.
Ash was all telling me, that's got to be the whole song. I'm like, Ash, calm down. Come on. No, you got to rewrite the whole fucking song. No, sir, I don't. I mean, I love working with Ash. He always throws out ideas, and then it's good. I'm down. I'm just glad he gave me a chance and let me put this record out on his label and have the great people that are involved that are helping me bring my vision to the world. And I'm very happy with him. I went to Sumerian Records because I knew I'd be treated very well. It feels good. It's a big independent label. There's not a lot of major label red tape, and you know, if you have a vision and Ash is into it and the label's into it, then you can, he helps it come true. I knew a lot of good people that went there, and I knew I'd be treated good. I'm a big fan of Crosses, and another reason I want to be on there because Chino was on there, and I'm also friends with T from Body Count. He did that one too. I think I take away from this journey that patience pays off. Don't ever count yourself out. And just always stay on path that it'll eventually all work itself out. May take a while. And yes, I got very depressed and very pissed off at times with me trying to get this record out. But, you know, it just wasn't the right time. And the right time is now. And I'm looking back and this is the only time it should have came out.
What you believe is your religion. And your entire devotion is dedicated to believing that. And there is no room for God in it.
The song, What You Believe, was inspired by Ross Robinson's mother. She is a self-help guru. She's been on Oprah. She's been on tons of things. She runs this house, and her thing is called The Work. I was listening to some of this, and this sample came across of her talking about religion, and it says, what you believe is your religion, and everything you do encompasses just that, and there's no room for God in it. And when I heard that, I got chills all over my body. I'm like, finally someone gets it. What you believe and everything you're putting into this man-made version of what religion is bullshit. And it has nothing to do with what God really is pure love, because what everything else going on is horrible. Not to say that the good things come from church, but the majority of it has been negative. So that inspired me. So that word, what you believe is your religion. So that became the hook, and I started writing the song. These huge, big, fat Reese's guitars, and then these big drums. Me and Ray played these taiko drums, which are from Japan. And it's all real drums, us in the studio, just racking on stuff. Very organic, very cinematic. And it's just me talking about, you know, what you believe is your religion. In the end, it's all just opinion and the way you look at it. When I was young, getting into metal music, I got Motley Crue, Shout the Devil, Dio's Holy Diver record. And I was just starting to listen to heavy music. My father became born again and grabbed all my tapes, said they were satanic, and burned them all. So I wasn't allowed to listen to that kind of music. I'm glad it happened, because it pushed me in a different area where I started listening to more industrial bands, and I got into goth bands, and I had to listen to that stuff behind his back, but it pushed me that way. There's nothing satanic about music. It makes me go crazy and insane. And even the thought of Satan himself, the whole demon. Satan was a fucking angel, man. He's just a fallen angel. He's the patron saint of music. His name is the Light Bearer. I mean, there's so many clues. Come on, I'm trying to figure this out in my head. And anyone that's got any kind of fucking intelligence should know there's something more to the story. So I don't hate. I said some stupid shit back that I was a satanic Christian, but all that means is I believe in balance. Everything balances itself out. Without no good, there would be no evil. Without evil, there would be no good. We need to have these things. Back in the day, 3 years old, my parents did Jesus Christ Superstar, a local production here. My father was in the band. He was heading up the music department, the orchestra in the pit. He played piano and keyboards and stuff. And my mother was one of the dancers in it. And my soon-to-be stepfather was Judas. I remember as a child them coming over and have rehearsals at the house, and that made me want to do music. I saw that, and I'm like, I want to be a rock star. I want whatever it is. Funny story is that my mom ended up leaving my father and marrying Judas. So Judas Judas'd my dad, and to this day, he's still with my mom. My mom just passed, God rest her soul, but he's there, and it was a big part of my life. So that whole musical and everything, of being so young, really pushed me into wanting to do something, one, in music, and then start questioning where I come from in religion, basically at a very early age. This whole record is based on is just me coming to terms with my journey and trying to figure out where I come from.
This is an official document from the Office of the Mayor of the City of Bakersfield, California. February 24th is an official proclamation as Corn Day in Bakersfield. So every February 24th is Corn Day up in my town. It's nice to be recognized from your town. It's dope. You gotta go see our street too. It's right down the street. Corn Row.
What?
You've never seen Corn Row?
No, I'm gonna go look at it.
I've gotta ask you too about, so being back home in Bakersfield, you know what I mean? Where you grew up, where you're from.
Yes.
One of the coolest things for me is, you know, the history there musically with Buck Owens and
Merle Haggard.
Merle Haggard.
A guy named Billy Mize, Homer Joy. Those were all Bakersfield people that wrote out. The Streets of Bakersfield was written by Homer Joy. These guys were the architects of the Bakersfield sound. A lot of really cool history. I remember they wanted to turn the bass down and turn the treble up and all the guitars. So, like, at that time, there was just AM radio. So that the sound would jump out of the speakers. It was like tearing the speakers. It was like when you knew a Bakersfield sound song would come on, you knew it because you would hear it. It was just so much different than everything else at the time. And they took over country music. It was like the punk rock version of country music at the time.
Yeah.
You know, Bakersfield, Nashville West.
Yeah, absolutely. And Buck Owens, you know, I mean, well, now you own a studio, correct?
Yeah, I'm in the old compound that he had back then. Now he has a new one on his street now, Buck Owens Boulevard, and he's got the Crystal Palace there, and the Owens family still runs it, and his old producer and keyboard player, dear friends with some of the original bands still around, they play on the nights. I'm just blessed to be able to be in that building. There's something there that's very magical. Everybody that came from Bakersfield was from the Dust Bowl days. It was from Arkansas, Missouri, Texas. So there's that still kind of mentality there. It's like families do business together with a handshake, and it's very ultra conservative. There's a church on every corner, and that's great.
Yeah, it's really cool.
It's just like honor, and when you give your word there, it means something, and I just like it. It's just my kind of place.
Wow, it's been a while since I played. I've been working really hard on a new record.
I came here to Bakersfield, and I played this little bar here. We were going to do Love on the Rocks, and I invited my dad to play with him. The first time that we'd played together since I was 5, because I used to play drums in his bands when we'd play bars here in Bakersfield. So this was my turn to have him come up, and we got to play Love on the Rocks together, and it was just really touching, cool moment to be able to play with my dad.
Anyways, this is Love on the Rocks with the Old Diamond People featuring Rick Davis, my brother.
There's nothing like that. It's just, I don't know how to explain it. It's just like a little winner. That's a man that helped make me, you know?
My dad, everybody!
So Gender is about Buffalo Bill. You know, Silence of the Lambs is one of my favorite movies. I love the Buffalo Bill character. I love that movie with Hannibal, you know, and back and forth. And I just wanted to write a song about it.
I came in your window last night like a ghost.
Part digital, part analog. You know, we got a lot of, you know, the violins and some of the tabla, and Miles doing bass on it, and some of the, I played the sitar on it, the sitar guitar. It's just this really dark.
Cool.
love the world music vibe. A lot of just fun. We had a lot of fun toys to play with: taikos, different kinds of drums, djembes, sirdos, all kinds of different percussion instruments. It up and it just makes this crazy, you feel it. It's like more, you don't hear it as much as you feel the low end coming from that thing. Buffalo Bill is modeled after a guy named Richard Speck and Ed Gein. Ed Gein wanted to make a girl suit. He made a people suit. Richard Speck, he actually had a pit in his basement and kept women down there as sex slaves. He'd starve them and he'd freak out because he would have sex with them and then put them back down in the pit. And then he started getting paranoid, thinking that they were plotting against him. So he jumped down in that pit and popped their eardrums with a screwdriver. He was torturing, shocking them and torturing them because he was a sick sadomasochist and accidentally killed one. He killed one of the girls, and so he didn't know what to do, so he chopped them up in blenders and fed them with dog food back to the girls. It's a fucking horrifying story, but I was just inspired and, you know, by just the dark side of man. Not necessarily I like it, and I don't agree with anything that those people did, but being from working in true crime at the coroner's office doing autopsy, stuff like that, of course that's something I want to check out.
This song is called Die Bitch. Die Bitch. Die Bitch, I fucking hate you. I wanna rip off your shitty face and shit down your throat. Pop your fucking face and shit down your... rip off your face and shit down your throat. Your fucking throat hole, that's it. Die Bitch, I fucking hate you. I wanna rip off your face and shit down your fucking throat hole. Yeah, you bitch. I'm gonna cut off your head and fix it to hell. It's my love song.
Terms of endearment.
Right? I got it.
I liked that character, Buffalo Bill. And hence the lyrics, can I wear your skin? Can I have it now? And I love the contrast of how beautiful the song is and how dark it is. I don't know. I don't question stuff that much. It's hard for me to really talk about it because I don't know. It's just whatever is coming out of my head. It is what it is.
Pretty soon you have to deal.
What it is, one of those songs just came together. I started off with that piano line and the melody line and wrote lyrics. And at that time, 10 years ago, I was starting to get in it. And it rings true more now, 10 years later, that, you know, depression and things like that. I mean, it all stems with unfinished business. It all stems with not coming in to face to face with what haunts you and not dealing with it. For me, it's the what it is. You know, you got to accept for what it, you know, what it is. You got to come up and confront that and do whatever you got to do to get it out of your life and put that to rest. And you'll see once you do that, your demons will start to have no more power in your life. They can't feed off that stuff because you've dealt with it and filed it away. I really think that this song was meant to come out now because now more than ever, people are dealing with this. And it's my way to give back and just share a little knowledge of what I've been through and how in my life I've changed things to make me happier. And it's kind of gives you the whole vibe of the whole record.
Jonathan's first hit right there.
Touchdown!
Touchdown! This
instrument wise, you know, saxophone, keys, he's playing piano, had Wes playing acoustic guitar on that. I love Wes. I've known him since the beginning when Biscuit started. You know, it was all about Fred, but I think us darker creative types know and can see stuff like that. We can pick each other out in a crowd or in the band. I always know which one's gonna be my homie, and Wes and me always clicked on that level. He's from a different planet and I respect it, and his musicianship's through the roof, and he's an all-around package. He's an amazing artist. He paints, he makes weapons. He creates instruments and does things sonically and projects that I think are amazing. So of course I wanted him on the record to play. And I just thought it was awesome that he would just do that for me and come and do that. So stoked that he did it. And I'm a huge fan of his solo work. And he's just an all around amazing artist.
I'm gonna try to do Kenny Rogers. You know the Kenny Rogers beard?
Got to know and hold on. Know and fold on. I don't know the song at all.
How you doing today, man?
Sorry. I can smell my own breath.
That guy breathes really hard out of his nose when he says yeah. Something. Stop.
Stop, y'all. What's going on?
Musician types. Weird fuck.
Yep.
I mean, Gansfield. Experiment is part of figuring out, I guess, you know, that there's different stuff out there. The theory behind it is when your brain is deprived of vision and your senses, that your brain has to make something up. Why does your brain have to make something up? Is it because it's connected to something that it has to keep doing that, or will it fuck up some programming? What really is, why does it do that? There's got to be a reason why, and I want to know those answers. I'm sure their answers are out there, I just don't know them yet. And I'm trying to figure it out. One thing I want people to take away when they get done listening to the record is I did my job and took them out of their body for 40 minutes or however long the record is. Did you get some relief from life? Give you some joy?
Rock and roll.
Take you to a special spot? I know where mine is when I listen to certain music like that. Take the weight of the world off their shoulders, to take away just those problems in life that all get us down. Give us a little relief from that and enjoy what I created and painted. That's all I ask.